Thank you. Very good afternoon. Hello and namaste from India. As just Tim said, so you know that I'm a highly confused man. I actually have no idea what I'm trying to do in life. And I'm a firm believer in somebody said once that life is what happens when you're busy planning it. So I said, forget about planning. There's no planning in my life. Just go with the flow and let's see what happens, where I go. So one day, suddenly, I got a mail from Oliver saying that Satya, why don't you come and give a talk? So I said, well, fine, that's good. Zurich is a nice place. So what do I talk about? He said, anything. Now, that's a typical Swiss answer, which means nothing, but it implies a lot, and you can't mess with a Swiss. So I realized that actually I know nothing about anything. So the only thing that I can share with you is my own life story, which is precisely 35 years of vertical nonsense in 18 minutes. Oh, well, I've already lost 1 minute out of that. So I like to believe that I'm a traveler without a destination. Unlike SBB, I don't have a station of origin. I definitely don't have a station of destination. I'm just a guy who is just passing by. That's about it. That's me. So today what I'll try to do is I'll take you, all of you, with me to some of the remotest, some of the prettiest, some of the most hostile spots on Earth. Many of these places, I was the first man to ever step and take a picture. I won't take any names, you know. So we would pretty much cover all the continents except Australia, because Australia does not excite me at all. Apologies to any Australians lovers here. Because what kind of continent is it which doesn't have big glaciers and mountains covered with snow? Not exciting at all. Yeah, that's why I love Switzerland. And please invite me again next year, okay, Tim? So you can't deny that I actually asked for it, okay? I have so many witnesses. All right. Yeah. So, we have seen the world of magic and technology, which he showed us with 3 mobile phones. But let's enter the world of natural magic, where the batteries will never run out. You don't have to recharge it. It's all around you. Let's go there. But before that I do, let's begin our quest with a question, with 2 questions, actually. I know it's pretty boring to see just 1 slide, but don't worry, there are lots of it, and I'll really rush through it. I've got 15 minutes. This clock is fascinating, you know, like, I don't know what I'm doing here. Okay, it's like my time is running out. I'm going to collapse, and somebody's going to shoot me, actually, with a bazooka, you know, like, if I don't finish it, yeah? Okay, all right, here it is. The question that I get most often fielded across the world, because I do a lot of talks here, and they ask me that, how do you do it? I'm not going to define what it is, but they ask me, how do you do it? And my steady answer is exactly the way a human body has been designed to do it. All right? Because I'm also a human being. Fine. But I'll go to the next question, which is more interesting and which really does not have any definite answer. And the question is, what on earth do I do for a living? Believe me, I have no idea. And if I'm sitting on a place like that, you see that? That's where I'm hanging most of the time in my life. It's very difficult to come up with a good answer. So I have devised of 3 options, you know, option A and B and C, depending on the situation, depending on the audience. First is have fun, which doesn't get me girlfriends at all, because, you know, who wants to be with a guy who just wants to have fun? So then I thought, okay, let me go to the next answer, which is I do nothing. So the girl is okay, but her parents are not well, because I cannot let my girl date a guy who does nothing. I mean, come on. Man. So I thought of a very exciting answer, and which is for an audience like this. Now, this may or may not be true, but this is the answer I give, okay? So, dear friends, welcome to my vertical world. This is where I live, a world without boundaries. Now, I love this world because boundaries only exist in the horizontal plane. It doesn't exist. You can, from Zurich, you can go right up to moon and nobody's going to check your visa or passport, right? So, I love my world. Thank you. I absolutely love this world, and that's why I don't even want to come into the horizontal land, okay? So let's begin our journey. As any journeys should begin, ideally, I believe people wake up at 3 in the morning in Zurich and go to work, so we'll also start very early in the morning. Just some pictures. I'm not going to take any name because then people will say, oh, you know, you like Greenland more than Switzerland, so no names, okay? They're just from all over the world. Now, when you look at this, what is it telling us? Mountains have taught me 2 very important lessons in life. First, is that human beings are so insignificant, so fragile, so useless in a way, actually, in front of nature. Because there's nothing, I mean, we can do with the mountains. At the same time, it has also taught me that if you want, how strong, how determined and how focused you can be. That's what mountain teaches. It's kind of opposite. On one hand, it tells me that you are absolutely useless and pathetic. You're good for nothing. But at the same time, it says that if I want to be, then I can be. I can almost achieve anything. People often say that I have conquered Everest. Well, I've climbed Everest 3 times. But people use the word conquering in a lot of mountaineering world. We do it. And people often, thank God Tim didn't use this word against me. Otherwise, I would have sued him for defamation. Because I have not conquered anything. If at all I have conquered, it's my own weakness, my own limitations, my own shortcomings. That's it. Because there's no way. I mean, you look at these pictures. Can you even imagine human beings conquering this? Come on. I mean, the thought itself is ridiculous. Yeah, it's crazy. Look at this. Now look at us. That is the scale. That is, there we are. Come on, we are nothing. One flick and we are gone forever. And these, when you look at this, you start believing in God. You know, this was my, because when I was 4, I was introduced to the mountains by my dad. And that's the only good thing he did in his life, actually. And then he passed away. I lost him very young. But this did something to me at the age of 4. And I realized that there has to be something beyond human. Something has to be beyond the cities and everything. Because this is not man. You know, this is supernatural. This is beyond. And that's how I grew up. Now, this view is, I must mention this view, because this is from the last camp on Everest on the north side. And you're looking down at some of the highest mountains in the world, and they're actually below you, which is fantastic. This is my true home. That's where I live for most of the time. This is wonderful because there's no phone calls coming in. You don't have to go anywhere. And even if you want to, where will you go, right? So it gives you a lot of time to introspect, a lot of time to think that what am I doing, who am I kind of stuff. I would expect that you become, evolve into a better human being by just being a climber and getting stuck in these kind of places. And when I do get stuck in these places, I really can't blame somebody because, nobody forced me to get there. I am there. I mean, willingly I have gone there. Now, this is one thing that if you go into the outdoors, you really go, not like climbing Eiger or Jungfrau or Matterhorn in Switzerland, because then you are totally surrounded by civilization, by a lot of mobile phone, I believe. I mean, these days you can make a mobile call from the top of Everest, actually. It has been achieved last year, which I think is like criminal, you know, it's outrageous. But when you go to places where you're totally distanced from the rest of the world and there is no external influence on you, that is the only time, believe me, that is the only time when you'll start listening to your heart and to your soul. And you'll start asking yourself questions that you wouldn't otherwise dare to ask yourself back in the city. This is one of my thoughts. Mountains have all the answers, no matter what your question is. But if you look in reality, it's not the mountain which comes out with the answers, it's you from deep within. Because you, when you go into this nature, you find the key to unlock yourself, unlock your heart, unlock your soul. Sitting in Zurich or Geneva, let's say, you don't even have the time to look for the key. But here, hello, you have nothing else to do, right? And you could be stuck in a tent for 10 days, you know, like praying every moment, oh God, please come and save me. So you will find the key because you have nothing else to do. You'll be kind of driven towards inner side. And for me, that's what I do. All my journeys are within. They're not to the top of any mountain. It doesn't matter where I reach, because for me, summit is not really all that important. But it's where I reach deep inside myself. And it's a discovery. Now, when you hang from such places, it's literally hanging. You're looking vertically down. You do come up with lots of questions, many of them funny, many of them irrelevant. Most of these questions actually doesn't have any answers. But you do come up with very philosophical questions like, who am I? Right? Who am I? You don't really say that I'm so-and-so, I'm the CEO of so-and-so, and I have a wife and kid. No, the real question, who am I? What do I want in life? Where do I go from here? But the question that comes, you can see me climbing somewhere up there. But the question that I often ask myself that what the hell on earth are you doing when I'm stuck in these kind of places? Because my friends are having a warm jacuzzi somewhere and having a nice shrimp salad or something like that, and I'm there freezing my butt off. So these are the questions which are which should be asked in your normal daily life, I guess. And that's what happens to you naturally. You don't really have to force yourself to find that journey within, because like I said, you have nothing else, nowhere else to go. These are the spectacles. Now, this is another thing I'll tell you. When I do a lot of motivational talks to people who are really, really sad in life. And I have seen that money is not equal to happiness, which I'm sure most of you agree, but you are unable to escape that what should I say, trap. Because equation, especially in Switzerland, is, okay, if I have got a million in my bank, logically I should be a very happy person. What gives you happiness? This is a bit philosophical, but like any mountaineer, you would become a philosopher. What gives you happiness in life is acceptance. Accepting who you are, accepting what I have got, and just being happy with it. Now, when you are facing an avalanche like this, and I have faced avalanches like this many, many times, the most recent has been last month when I was doing a first ascent in Afghanistan. I was buried in the avalanche for 40 minutes, and I thought that, fine, I will not be able to go to TEDx Zurich. That was my first thought. I said, oh shit, Oliver is going to kill me if he really finds my body one day. So I was very sad, Tim, that I'll be upsetting your fantastic Swiss schedule, and I was really shit scared of the Swiss. Maybe that's why. But anyway, what I'm seeing is that when I was there, I was walking under this massive vertical face of ice. I had two of my friends. They are among the best climbers in the world. Thank God for that. That's why I'm here today in front of you. They had crossed this face, and I was going to cross it. But I was right in the middle of it when this entire face broke. Not my fault. I had no idea this was going to happen because they had crossed it just half an hour before me. And I saw this about a few thousand tons of ice rushing towards me, and I said, accept it. It's my destiny. That's it. And I was very happy about it. I was not panicking. There's no fear. There's no scare at all. And accepting it. Let's see what happens. So most of us are very scared to do things. We plan too much, you know. We try to find out everything. And this Google is really spoiling us. Believe me, it is. I mean, apologies to the Google guy who was here. But your maps are killing it. I mean, we are not like Shackleton anymore. Where is the thrill of finding out for myself? I don't want second-hand knowledge from somebody else. No. Let me go and fall in that, that hole in the road and find out, yeah, there is a hole, right? I could curse somebody that, why didn't you tell me there is, but fine. But I'm experiencing it, okay? So we, in this generation, I think we are losing the sense of adventure. Oh my goodness, I have only 6 minutes, okay. That's another example of an avalanche. And believe me, when this avalanche was happening, I was actually running towards it because I wanted to take a video from inside the avalanche, which perhaps nobody has done so far. Here's the story. I got the video, but the camera did not survive. So I'm very sorry I don't have that video. Thank you. It's funny, okay? I make up a lot of stories. I don't believe half of the things that I say. Okay, there's another philosophy of mine that it's, you can apply it in your life, that anything that you do, it might be big, like finding a bus in CERN, or it could be something very small, like making $50 million in the stock market. But forget about where you want to go. Focus on your step, because that's important. You cannot take away the step, okay? Every step is important. And at any given point of time, you ask yourself, can I do anything more than taking my next step? So why should you worry? I mean, if I look at the mountain, let's say look Mount Everest from the north side and said, you know, I'm going to go up there. Believe me, I'll be so demoralized and discouraged that I wouldn't even try it. But if I say, forget about it, just one step, come on. Anybody can take one step. Even if you're dying, you can literally pick your step and put it forward. One step, that's all. When my team members are very exhausted, they're about to die and collapse and say, Satya, this is it, like this is my limit. I said, look, forget about the summit, forget about food, forget about everything else. Can you give me just one more step? That's all I'm asking. It could be 6 inches, it could be 12 inches, it could be 18 inches if you're really, really tall, but give me one step. And believe me, that's a great source of motivation because this guy suddenly says, I can take one step. And my leader is not asking anything more than that. If you apply this in your life, if you apply this in your corporate life, you'll see it's a fantastic motivating factor. Don't bullshit the guy because he lost something. Just say, come on, take one step, man. You can do it, right? And believe me, you can do it. These are some of my steps that I take often. It's crazy. I'm not saying you to take these kind of steps. But they're nice steps. This is the most famous step in the world. Any answers? You have 5 seconds to react because I don't have time. What step are you looking at? Yeah, there you are, Hillary step, the most famous step in the world. Okay, this is purely my belief. You could call me a sadist or a masochist, but I think this is it. If you don't suffer, you really don't enjoy something, okay? And in this way, I say that people say that I'm an extreme adventurer, I'm a fantastic guy, I'm a biggest adventurer, but I say, look, I respect those who are married because they suffer more than me. I mean, you are climbing Everest every day of your life. I mean, how do you do it, you know? So my respect to them. And I think maybe they are enjoying life more than me because they have gone through the hardship, or they are going through the hardship. But when you go through the hardship, you see these kind of sights, and it makes absolutely worth it. Absolutely worth it. That I was on the verge of dying. I had starved for maybe 5 or 6 days. I'm getting frostbitten or whatever. Thank God I haven't lost anything yet. But it just makes it absolutely worth it. This picture is shot inside a crevasse. When I actually fell into a crevasse, I was bleeding to death. And I said, okay, what the heck? I mean, just enjoy it. You know, like I'm lying up, looking up. So I just took this picture. And I think it's a pretty good shot, you know, given the fact that I was bleeding, almost losing my consciousness, and I knew I was going to die. But there it is. I'm not. This is important. Very important. Should you stop at your next goal? Once you have achieved something, should you stop there and be happy with it? No. Where is the sense of exploration? You know, when I climb a mountain, what I realize that how much more I have to climb, how many more mountains are beyond. So there are many times people ask me, why do you climb all the time? I said, look, it's just to see what lies beyond, how much more I have to go. So there's always so don't be satisfied. Be content, but not satisfied. Okay? There's always a mountain beyond where you have reached, and I have got less than 2 minutes now. Okay, like I said, my masochistic attitude. This is my suffering. I love it. No problem. No complaints at all. Just frozen bits of eye patches. Once my eyeballs almost cracked because it froze. It was about minus 65 degrees centigrade. And I had gone out to answer nature's call, so it happened. And I was not very careful. This I talk about the walrus picture of mine because I've got this big teeth growing up. And this is in Antarctica, by the way. And at the end of it, of course, like I said, you get to see places which most people can't even imagine, can't even dream about. Important. We all have Everest to climb in our life. Just now somebody showed us an example of Matterhorn because we are in Switzerland, but otherwise people talk about Everest. We all have Everest, more than one. And we all climb them in our own style. So I won't debate that your style is better than mine or mine is better than you, as long as you reach the summit, as long as you reach your personal summit. I make a difference. Geographical summit is not equal to the personal summit. This is how I like to climb, because I always like shortcut, a straight line between 2 points, and I normally take that. This is how I climb. Most of the times, I sometimes fall as well. Very important. So there are places where I know that I just cannot fail. You can see me somewhere up there. I can't see myself. And can I get a grace of 1 minute? Not really, I think. Okay, I'll just rush through this. Sorry, I've spoken too much. But you can see that these are the places where failure is not an option. And it's a great motivating factor. Mountain is not all about life and death and rock and things. You can see all these pretty pictures from the mountains. 10 seconds. Mountain people who are beautiful. And this is my definition of adventure. Quickly read it. 3 seconds only. This is where you'll find me. Okay, I'll end with this. 5 seconds. Mountains have really taught me to live each moment, because I know that this moment could be my last. And for that very reason, you all are my dearest friends at this moment, because you could be the last person I'll see in this life. Thank you, and I'll see you all on top.